Thank you. Timothy screamed bloody murder as they dropped, and Florian feared his fingers might snap free of the force of the swinging. The bridge was rapidly being hauled in as they fell to try and keep them from smashing against the hull, but no such luck, because when Tim fell, he was anchored only by his feet and swung right down onto Florian, careening their trajectory like a wrecking ball into the side of the ship. Being flattened against the ship by a man that felt like a two-ton iron frying pan was not the way Florian had predicted he would die, but for a moment he seemed so sure and so asinine that he burst into a laugh. That is, he would have, if the wind hadn't been knocked clean out of him. Disoriented by the impact, the sound of a new wave of gunfire and Timothy's continued screeching as he dangled upside down on top of him, Florian's grip slackened. Scrambling as his fingers slid over the thick netting, he dropped an inch, then a foot, then stopped with a lurch. "Haul in," he heard Jack's voice below him, looked down, and sure enough, sandy hair and broad shoulders wrapped around his legs. Jack had him with an arm under the seat of his pants, with his head pressed to Florian's ribcage. He looked up to Florian from where he'd been shouting to Mikhail. Florian had argued with all he had to avoid this route, but the captain would not be swayed. It was assumed to shave 3 days off their voyage that they might race their cargo back to the drop-off destination before any trouble could catch them. The fact that Florian had been warned against this route when he was in the shipping business would not be heeded, nor would any reference to local superstition that kept most sailors away, since their dear captain had been certain such superstitions were destined to hide a superior path and Florian had not been on the crew long enough to convince him with just his word. And thus, here they were. In the smug sensation of being correct once again for his weariness, if he weren't currently frozen to the bone using every fiber of his being to bend the waves to his will. The ship groaned, and there was a banging and clamoring from below deck, but the door to the galley and beyond had been tied shut by Florian and by Mary, who was his only supporting crewmate on deck, a girl of 12, who was unaffected by the soft, luring melody carried in the damnable wind, and who now wrestled the wheel of the ship away from the encroaching cliffs of stone, which reared up like jagged teeth from water on either side. And below them, sirens. Sirens, of course. Thank you. Florian had argued with all he had to avoid this route, but the captain would not be swayed. It was assumed to shave 3 days off their voyage that they might race their cargo back to the drop-off destination before any trouble could catch them. The fact that Florian had been warned against this route when he was in the shipping business would not be heeded, nor would any reference to local superstition that kept most sailors away, since their dear captain had been certain such superstitions were destined to hide a superior path, and Florian had not been on the crew long enough to convince him with just his word. And thus, here they were.
Oh!
Gentle, glistening blackness of the sea had always been a great comfort in Jack's longest nights. The wind was just enough to make the odd loose sail flutter like the sound of wings. Alone on deck, Jack listened. He'd taken the dog watch again. It suited him to have these quiet hours lately. His chin rested in crossed arms as he leaned on the starboard guardrail of the Triton scale. The ship was the closest thing he'd had to a home. It had always been his shield. One tiny refuge in a fathomless blue maelstrom, a roiling void that he could not resist even as it hungered endlessly for him, reaching for him, always. Now the ship, the sea, was different. The shield became a swinging door. The ocean's hunger became a greeting. He was different. His body was new to him in ways that felt more like home than any vessel had. He was stronger and hungrier in more ways than one. Things smelled and tasted differently. His teeth could cut bone. His ears could pick out a heartbeat at three paces. Underwater, he was downright alien and fearless. He was also a man alive who knew what it was to die.
Ah! Forward! Thank you. Thank you.
Ara, mercifully, stopped near Jack as the rest split off to gather their pieces of the puzzle. Jack's true role would come later. He just needed to dress the stage and hold out until then. Easy enough. Their first night was, in fact, full of drinking and dancing. For most. For all, it rolled by without any terrible incident. Florian found Jack more than once, met by Ara's rolled eyes and whispered variations of, "You, Den, go and do your job so we can get out of these frills you painted, bar wench." But he inevitably glanced by all the same, never letting Jack leave his eyeline, like a moon orbiting its Earth.
Thank you.
Ara, mercifully, stopped near Jack as the rest split off to gather their pieces of the puzzle. Jack's true role would come later. He just needed to dress the stage and hold out until then. Easy enough. Their first night was, in fact, full of drinking and dancing. For most. For all, it rolled by without any terrible incident. Florian found Jack more than once, met by Ara's rolled eyes and whispered variations of, "You dead? Go and do your job so we can get out of these frills you painted, bar wench." But he inevitably glanced by all the same, never letting Jack leave his eyeline, like a moon orbiting its earth. Ara, mercifully, stopped near Jack as the rest split off to gather their pieces of the puzzle. Jack's true role would come later. He just needed to dress the stage and hold out until then. Easy enough. Their first night was, in fact, full of drinking and dancing. For most. For all, it rolled by without any terrible incident. Florian found Jack more than once, met by Ara's rolled eyes and whispered variations of, "You dead? Go and do your job so we can get out of these frills you painted, bar wench." But he inevitably glanced by all the same, never letting Jack leave his eyeline, like a moon orbiting its earth. The sea is a fickle mistress, Florian thought, as he ran across the deck, aiming higher on the starboard side as the Triton's gale rocked hard to port. The deck slanted so violently that some of the crew went sliding past, but not Florian. He was born again in a storm many, many years ago. Though he may fear death at the hands of those mighty, towering waves, he wouldn't bend to her. Not today.
Thank you. Thank you. Doors.
day Ondine's world ended was not the day she had drowned. On that day, she had only traded the endless blue above for the fathomless below. Her life before was so small and so long ago, she did not know for certain whether her only memory of it was a construct of dreams. Two pairs of bare feet planted in damp earth, among an expanse of lush grass laced with clustered white flowers stretched to a rolling horizon. The abandoned bridal shroud of some forgotten goddess. If it was truly the last surviving vision of a first world, then it had been, perhaps mercifully, ruminative. Clear of any hands that might have guided her, arms that might have held her, eyes that would miss her. Save for those feet. Those feet that had surely walked with her, now planted firmly in a heart that begged to walk again. sea is a fickle mistress, Florian thought as he ran across the deck, aiming higher on the starboard side as the Triton scale rocked hard to port. The deck slanted so violently that some of the crew went sliding past, but not Florian. He was born again in a storm many, many years ago. Though he may fear death at the hands of those mighty, towering waves, he wouldn't bend to her. Not today. Thank you. Apologies, my dear, Florian said to the noble lady. She had white blonde hair and wore green and gold with her expression of amused shock. It seems that the lieutenant has had too much of your fine champagne to entertain you properly. He took Jack's single, empty glass from Aura, who'd seamlessly saved it from shattering when Jack had been ambushed, and turned it upside down. At this, and at Jack's signature scoff of offense, rather like an old woman's, the pale lady laughed. It was a pretty laugh, forgiving. Such was Florian's spell. I'm afraid, as respectable gentlemen, Florian continued with a roguish smile, we must retire before we forget ourselves and do something scandalous. The look Aura gave him could have roasted a chicken. Florian bid his formal good night and pretended to support Jack as they were all shown to their accommodations. Jack leaned into him, perhaps more than strictly necessary. Thank you. Ara, mercifully, stopped near Jack as the rest split off to gather their pieces of the puzzle. Jack's true role would come later. He just needed to dress the stage and hold out until then. Easy enough. Their first night was, in fact, full of drinking and dancing. For most. For all, it rolled by without any terrible incident. Florian found Jack more than once, met by Ara's rolled eyes and whispered variations of, "You, Den, go and do your job so we can get out of these frills you painted, bar wench." But he inevitably glanced by all the same, never letting Jack leave his eyeline, like a moon orbiting its earth. Aura, mercifully, stopped near Jack as the rest split off to gather their pieces of the puzzle. Jack's true role would come later. He just needed to dress the stage and hold out until then. Easy enough. Their first night was, in fact, full of drinking and dancing. For most. For all, it rolled by without any terrible incident. Florian found Jack more than once, met by Aura's rolled eyes and whispered variations of, "You, Den! Go and do your job so we can get out of these frills you painted, bar wench." But he inevitably glanced by all the same, never letting Jack leave his eyeline, like a moon orbiting its earth. Gentle, glistening blackness of the sea had always been a great comfort in Jack's longest nights. The wind was just enough to make the odd loose sail flutter like the sound of wings. Alone on deck, Jack listened. He'd taken the dog watch again. It suited him to have these quiet hours lately. His chin rested in crossed arms as he leaned on the starboard guardrail of the Triton's gale. The ship was the closest thing he'd had to a home. It had always been his shield. One tiny refuge in a fathomless blue maelstrom, a roiling void that he could not resist even as it hungered endlessly for him, reaching for him, always. Now the ship, the sea, was different. The shield became a swinging door. The ocean's hunger became a greeting. He was different. His body was new to him in ways that felt more like home than any vessel had. He was stronger and hungrier in more ways than one. Things smelled and tasted differently. His teeth could cut bone. His ears could pick out a heartbeat at three paces. Underwater, he was downright alien and fearless. He was also a man alive who knew what it was to die.